My name is Reverend Marian Edmonds-Allen, and I'm the Executive Director of Parity, which is an LGBT advocacy organization based out of New York City, and we do national work at the intersection of faith and LGBT. It's shifted a lot, so we have had to pivot as an organization to meet the needs of the moment, and what we found was that churches needed to close their doors and not have people worship in person. So what we did was we started the online faith collective so that churches who were providing online worship services could then provide those worship services outside their congregations. So people who couldn't access worship now could access worship, perhaps at a different church. So we've been doing that, as well as gathering together pastor volunteers willing to be part of what we call a virtual pastor network to connect people, say on the front lines, people who are grieving, with a volunteer pastor who will pray with them, provide compassionate listening, and those types of things. Plus, a lot of meeting the need. People need food, people need an ear. So we're matching up volunteers with the many, many people in need right now. There is more of an impact for LGBT people because these are folks who may have more health concerns, may have more economic concerns, may not have community support or family support. So a lot of these folks, particularly transgender people of color, a lot of these folks don't have a lot of support to begin with. And now with more food insecurity, with being, say, a queer homeless youth on the street, the services which were spotty to begin with, now many services have just gone away as service organizations figure out how to provide what they do safely. So we're just seeing more and more need that is more and more urgent. But we're also seeing congregations and just people who want to help. So it's providing people opportunities to help those folks in need. So for our online faith collective, we say right up front that it's LGBT friendly. And getting the word out to folks means doing, say, Facebook advertisements and so on. But there are so many people in the world that hate the idea of LGBT and faith that they're all over it saying things that are hateful and hurtful. So that someone who is LGBT and a person of faith, or maybe someone who just wants to give it a try again, because that's what we're seeing in the world, is that people have more of a longing for faith and that church attendance is up. But there are folks who it's crazy making for them to think about an LGBT person claiming to be a person of faith. And as I mentioned to you, when I get death threats, it's not because I'm an activist, and I'm surely a loud activist. It's for the work I do when I talk about being an LGBT person who is a Christian. That is what is crazy making for folks right now. And that's why we need to raise awareness and make faith available to all people. Every person should have that in their life if they choose it. I have, absolutely. A lot of what I do in the world is bridging work, what I call being blessed by difference. And I have seen people who have been very rejecting of LGBT folks, people who have been on the front lines of trying to take LGBT equality and to prevent marriage equality, seen those folks have their hearts melted and seen them with tears streaming down their faces when they hear the stories that are the stories of my life and the story of a 16-year-old girl sleeping in the snow in front of her high school because she couldn't get help when her parents, her religious parents, kicked her out. These are the stories that melt hearts. And then when those rejecting folks now become affirming or just want to help, that's when we can get some beautiful work done and laws change and hearts and minds change. It's a beautiful, hopeful thing. No, I'm seeing it now because people do have such good hearts, particularly faith people, but other people as well. Mm-hmm. So when they hear about, say, homeless youth, they want to be right there. They want to donate their time, their money, their prayers, whatever they can do to help. So I'm seeing that even more now. And it's my hope that during this pandemic and after the pandemic, these divides, these false binaries that we have over LGBT and faith will go away, and that we'll come together to help the people that so desperately need our help. The one story that is so hopeful to me is the story of a pastor from a traditionally rejecting faith who was called upon to do a funeral for an elderly person. And that person had a child who was out and out gay person. And the family was very worried that the church wouldn't rally around and provide support for this family because of a gay child in the family. But what happened was that this traditionally rejecting pastor just had such a beautiful heart for the grieving family, and not only affirmed them as being a loving child of this deceased person, but also a person who could lead others in mourning for this person who had died. And now they have become so close, and this person attends the church, and they just have a loving relationship now. I'm not talking about theological change. I'm talking about a change of heart and a change in thinking about ministering with people who are different. And it's a beautiful thing, and it's happening more and more every day. So my fear is that there will be faith-based nonprofits, social justice organizations who will struggle and may cease to exist, particularly ones run by people of color, by transgender and LGBT folks. So my hope then is that we can work together to support each other in terms of organizing, because I see a terrific opportunity in the world for us to create a better world. We know that the oppressive systems resulted in excluded and marginalized people, and a lot of changes need to happen. And I feel like there are a lot of terrific people ready to move forward with that, and I'm already seeing that, and that's a beautiful thing. The other thing I see that's hopeful is this longing for faith and spirituality in people's lives, and the access to that faith and spirituality now through digital means is opening a window for folks who never thought they'd want to be part of a faith community again. So I'm hopeful about that too, and that we can bridge these divides together. I suggest what I always suggest, which is to look around carefully to our own lives to see who in our life might need some extra support, some extra love, extra care. This isn't a time when we can necessarily visit them, but we can make a phone call. We can send a note. So to when we see something that we think, I wonder if I can help there, don't second guess yourself. Just do it. Start with what you know. The bigger things are going to come, but let's do what we each can do in our daily lives. As I mentioned, I care very much about bridging divides. I think that we have so much more in common than we don't. So one thing that I suggest to folks who are interested in bridging divides in the world is to make a friend with someone who's very different from you. If it's an issue around faith, around LGBT, if it's around wearing a mask or opening the economy, make a friend or lean into that friendship or that relationship that you have with a family member. If you think to yourself, how can they think that way? That's a clue to you to find someone and ask them, and to listen with curiosity and compassion. Yeah, oh, I do it all the time. Oh. I have friends that I love deeply who I think they are whack-a-moles, and they think the same of me, because we agree about virtually nothing. In fact, I'm speaking tomorrow at a rally around religious liberty and state overreach and how terrible that is. And my friend who's organizing it asked me to speak as a faith leader. And I said, I wouldn't say anything that you want anyone to hear. And he said, that's why I want you there. I want your voice heard, even though you disagree with everything that we stand for. They told me that probably I'd hear things I don't want to hear, but I'm used to that. Yeah. And that I see that as my calling in the world, is to use my body to build bridges. So I was glad for the invitation, and I will be listening as well as speaking. Yeah. So there are good people out there who, even though they're very, very different, They want to see good come in the world. We all share the same goals, I think. Maybe not the same way to get there, but how can we do that together? Please join me in prayer. Holy One of many names, we come to you in expectation that you will hear our cries, cries of worry, cries of mourning, cries of powerlessness. We realize that our longing for normal is longing that falls short of the hope that lies in you. For we have the assurance that joy comes with the morning, the assurance that faith can move mountains, and that love is the very essence of you that moves in and through us. May we set your love before us as our guide, so that we journey together through dark times, we will see your light, a light that will never be extinguished. And may this everlasting light show us your way to listen deeply to those in need and to answer their cries. Holy One, may we be brave and bold in working for the excluded and alienated. May we be courageous and compassionate in reaching across divides. And may your light shine in us for all the world to see, today and every day. Amen.